Hello everyone, welcome to the video lecture on key management. First we'll go through the outline of this video. We'll be covering up introduction to key management, digital certificates, public key infrastructure, and finally identity based encryption. Key management is related to generation of keys, storage of keys, its distribution and backup of keys. In this chapter, we focus on the management of public and private key pairs. We know that public and private key pairs are used in encryption decryption process, signature generation verification process, and in authentication process. When it comes to encryption decryption, encryption makes use of public key and decryption makes use of private key. In signature generation verification, generation makes use of private key and verification makes use of public key. Now, if A and B are the two communicating parties, then the key issue is how does A knows B's public key? So there are three possibilities. First, A may frequently communicate with B in a secure fashion, so she may already have B's public key. In this case, we make an assumption that B must have securely communicated his public key to A at some point in the past. But the drawback with this possibility is that if any time B's private key is compromised, the confidentiality of the message from A to B using the corresponding public key can no longer be guaranteed. Second drawback is that if B's public and private key pair is changed, then the new public key should be securely communicated to A each time. Due to these drawbacks, the second possibility came into existence. That is, every entity's public key is securely maintained in a centralized directory. In this case, if A has to obtain B's public key, he need to query the directory. But the drawback is scalability. That is, an infrastructure to support this directory could become a bottleneck. So they came up with the third possibility, where A receives a document signed by the trusted source C containing B's public key. That is, a document containing B's public key is being signed by some trusted source C and then it is sent to A. We explore the last possibility in greater detail in the next section after introducing the idea of digital certificates. Next we'll see what is a digital certificate. A digital certificate is a signed document used to bind a public key to the identity of a person. Individual's identity could be his or her name, a national security number, an email address or a postal address, employer information or some combination of these. Now the entity that issues this certificate is called as certification authority. In short, we call it as CA. Now CAs are often selected government agency or it can be a bank as well. The question is, for whom we can issue these digital certificates? The certificates may be issued to an individual or it can be issued to an organization or even to servers. Next, we'll go through the types of certificates. So the most basic type of certificate may be applied through regular email with the applicant stating his or her public key, name, email address, and other identity information. In this case, the CA requires no credential from the applicant. It simply assumes the applicant is in possession of the private key corresponding to the public key received in the email. These certificates are only appropriate for application with the least demand of security. For more security, certificate issuance would require CA to perform identity verification of the applicant. This involves submission of credentials such as passport, driver license, Aadhaar card, etc. The CA may have to obtain and verify several details of the applicant, including his or her employer, email address, many more other identity information. Practically, this task would be delegated by the certifying authority to one more authority called as registration authority. So, in both the cases, it is often desirable that a CA or an RA may require the applicant to demonstrate the possession of private key corresponding to the public key presented. Next, we'll go through one of the digital certificate format, X.509. X.509 is an International Telecommunication Union standard specifying the format for public key certificates. The fields of these certificates are as follows. First one, certificate serial number and version. Each certificate issued by a CA will have a unique number called as certificate serial number. Next field is issuer information, that is nothing but the information of the certifying authority. The information include his or her name, the email address, the organization name, the country which they belong to, and other identity information of a certifying authority. Next field is subject information. This includes certificate subject's name, country, state, organization which they belong to, along with that their email address. Next field is subject's public key information. This includes the public key, algorithm used, the public key parameter. For example, if the public key algorithm is RSA algorithm, then they need to mention the key parameters, that is nothing but the modulus n and the exponent e value. The next field is validity period. So there are two date fields that specify the start date and end date between which the certificates are valid. The last field is certificate signature and associated signing algorithm information. So it is necessary to verify the authenticity of the certificate. For this purpose, it is signed by the issuer. So the certificate should include issuer's digital signature and also the algorithm used for signing the certificate. Next, we'll go through one of the digital certificate snapshot. As you can see, initially the version is mentioned, so the version number is 1. Next, the serial number is given, that is 3174. Next, signature algorithm, that is nothing but the CA algorithm used in order to sign the document. That algorithm is nothing but MD5 with RSA encryption. Then you have the issuer information, that is CA information, which includes C is equal to IN, which stands for country is equal to India, state is Maharashtra, location is Mumbai, O stands for organization, that is security center, and their email address as well. Then you have the validity period. Again, it has two fields, before and after, during which the certificate is valid. So validity starts from January 1st, 2010 till December 31st, 2010. Then you have subject information. Again, C is equal to IN, stands for country is equal to India, state is equal to Goa. Similarly, location, organization is Ocean Enterprises, and finally, subject's email ID. Then we have subject public key information. So the algorithm used, so it is RSA encryption. Then we have the public key parameters. The first parameter they have mentioned is modulus value. The next parameter they have mentioned is exponent value. Finally, we have the signature algorithm and the signed value. So this signature algorithm used is MD5 with RSA encryption, and the final value you can see, that is nothing but the signature generation value. If A and B are the two communicating parties, and if A has received B's certificate, before using it, we need to perform the following check. Firstly, check for the identity of B. This can be determined by checking whether the certificate contains B's name. Secondly, A should check if the certificate is still valid. Since the validity period is contained in the certificate, this can be checked easily. Finally, the certificate should be signed by a CA or an RA. For this, A should verify the signature contained in the certificate. For this, A requires the CA's public key. Since CA is globally known and A has access to CA's public key, this can be verified easily. That is nothing but the signature of the CA can be verified. Next, we'll go through public key infrastructure. A public key infrastructure includes the CAs, the physical infrastructure with encryption technologies, hardware, then finally the formulation and enforcement of policies and procedure. Now, for the smooth functioning of CAs and the physical infrastructure, we require some policies and procedure. So together with all these three components, we can have a public key infrastructure. Now, the public key infrastructure also includes the services required in supporting the use of digital certificates, like certificate creation, issuance, its storage and archival, key generation and key escrow, certificate or key updation, and finally certificate revocation. Now, what is key escrow? So sometimes there is a necessity of securely backing up of private key and make this private key available to the owner or the trusted authority under special circumstances. This process is called as key escrow. Next, we'll go through four types of PKI architectures. They are PKI with single CA, hierarchical or tree-based PKI architecture. Third one, mesh-based PKI architecture. Fourth, bridge-based PKI architecture. Next, we will go through each one of these architecture. First one, PKI with single CA. Here, one CA could issue certificate to multiple users, enabling any pair of these users to communicate securely using certificates exchanged between them. So in the diagram, we can see that there is a single CA, CA1, who is responsible for issuing certificates for the users U1, U2 up till UN. So each arc in the figure represents trust relationship. That is, an arc from CA1 to U2 represents that CA1 vouches for U2. That is nothing but CA1 is responsible for issuing certificate, digital certificate for U2. But the drawback with such architecture is scalability. That is, a single CA need to manage tens of millions of users, and one single CA is responsible for issuing certificates for n numbers of users. A practical solution to the problem of scalability is to have a single CA certify other CAs, who in turn verify other CAs, and so on. This creates a tree of CAs known as hierarchical PKI architecture. So in hierarchical PKI architecture, the root CA is sometimes referred to as a trust anchor, and it is expected that every node in the tree will know the root CA's public key. So in this diagram, we can see that the root CA is nothing but CA1, which in turn certifies CA2, CA3 and CA4. CA2 in turn certifies CA5 and user 1, CA5 in turn certifies U2 and U3. So if at all now user 1 wants to communicate with user 7, then user 1 needs user 7's public key. Now how that is generated? Now user 7 need to embed his public key in a document in order to create a digital certificate. Now that digital certificate is signed by CA6, which in turn will be certified or signed by CA3, which in turn will be signed by or certified by CA1. Now that digital certificate is sent to user 1. User 1, on receiving that digital signature, since he knows root CA's public key, he will verify the digital certificate. On verification, he will obtain CA3's public key. Using that, he will verify the certificate. In turn, he will obtain CA6 public key, which will be used in order to verify the certificate, from which he will obtain user 7's public key. Now using user 7's public key, user 1 can directly communicate with user 7. So the advantage of this approach is easy scalability. That is, each CA is responsible for certifying a limited number of users or other CAs. Since there is only one trust path for every user, the drawback of this approach is that if the private key of any CA is compromised in the path, then the confidentiality of the message over that trusted path is no longer guaranteed. To overcome this problem, we have mesh-based PKI. Here, the trust relationship between the CAs may be numerous than in a simple tree. This could include mutually trusting CAs. As you can see in the diagram, there is a bidirectional arrow between CA1 and CA2. This says CA1 vouches for CA2 and CA2 vouches for CA1, thus representing mutual trust. So if user 1 wants to communicate with user 7, there are two trust paths, that is from CA1 to CA2 and to CA4. The other trust path is CA1 to CA3 to CA4. So the advantage of mesh based PKI is that there may be multiple trust paths between two users. These paths provide greater resilience in the event of one or more CAs being compromised. Next, we'll go through the final architecture, bridge-based PKI. Bridge-based PKI is motivated by the need for secure communication between organization in a business partnership. Suppose that partnering organization already have their own PKIs, a bridge CA is introduced that establishes a trust relationship with the representative CA from each organization. This is accomplished by the bridge CA and the organizational representatives issuing certificate to each other. So the representative CA is the one that has a trust path to all the users in the organization. As you can see in the diagram, there are two organizations, organization A and organization B, who are in partnership. Now organization A, individually they have a tree based PKI architecture. Organization B has a mesh based architecture. Now they have to select one of the representative CA. So representative CA need to have a trust path to every individual in their organization. So in this case, in organization A, since it is a tree based structure, obviously the root node will be the representative CA. In case of mesh based, we need to select one of the CA as a representative CA which has a trust path with each of the individuals of the organization. Once the representative CAs are selected, now the communication between any user from organization A with the user with organization B happens via the bridge CA. That is nothing but bridge CA vouches for the representative CAs. Next, we will see what is certificate revocation. Certificate revocation is the process of invalidating an issued digital certificate before its scheduled expiration date. That is, a certifying authority can invalidate a digital certificate before its validity expires. Now the question is, what is the need of certificate revocation? Now let us consider two scenarios. First one, consider a subject Prashant who was issued a digital certificate with validity period between Jan 1, 2010 to December 31, 2010. However, he quits the organization on 1st April 2010. Now assume that Prashant's certificate is to be used for key exchange or authentication, and also he has made a copy of it. Now assume that another party uses the public key from the Prashant's digital certificate in a key exchange certificate to encrypt a random session key later after April 1st, 2010. Since Prashant has the private key corresponding to the public key in the digital certificate, he will be able to authenticate himself or perform authorized decryption even after leaving the organization. Thus, Prashant might continue to do business on behalf of his company even after resigning. But it is illegal for Prashant to act on behalf of his company beyond the date of his resignation. Now let us consider the second scenario. Consider a single chain in a PKI architecture as shown in the figure. Suppose now the private key of CA3 were compromised. An attacker with the access to the compromised private key could do the following. First one, generate a public and a private key pair called as X, Y. Second step, create a certificate containing the public key X with subject name U. Finally, sign the above certificate using the compromised private key of CA3, thus creating use digital certificate. Now the attacker has thus created an entity U acting as a legitimate subject. Now the attacker can forge the signature of U on any message by signing with the private key Y. The attacker would provide a certificate chain of two certificates. The certificate issued by CA1 vouching for CA3 and the above certificate created by him, that is U. This chain is valid trust path from the root of CA to the subject U. Using the public key of CA1 and the certificate chain, the verifier would accept the fraudulent signature generated using Y as an authentic signature of U. Now based on scenario 1, we need a mechanism to revoke certificate issued by an organization to an employee when the latter leaves or changes the role. The second lesson learned from scenario 2 is that if a CA's private key is compromised, then any certificate issued by the CA is invalid and it should not be included in any trust path or certificate chain. Now let us see how we can handle revocation. There are three solutions. First one, use an online facility that provides information on the current status of digital certificates. For this purpose, we use a protocol called Online Certificate Status Protocol, OCSP, is employed. That is, using this protocol, it gives the information about the current status of any digital certificate. Second solution is to distribute the list of revoked certificates, that is certificate revocation list. In short, it is called as CRLs. Now the frequency of the updation of the revocation list is an important factor. Now if the CRLs are distributed too frequently, they could consume considerable bandwidth. On the other hand, if they were distributed infrequently, information on recently revoked certificate may not reach to those who need it in a timely fashion. In both the previous solution, the verifier need to make sure that the certificate is currently valid. But it is possible to design a system wherein the signer requires the cooperation of the trusted third party called as TTP in generating a signature. So solution 3 explains how it is done. Both the signer and the trusted third party have a part of the private key with neither party knowing the other's part. Neither acting on their own can create a signature on the document. To sign a document, the signer would contact the TTP. The TTP would check whether the signer's certificate has not been revoked. If it is not been revoked, the TTP will sign the document. Now, in this case, the TTP itself will maintain the certificate revocation list. The TTP may also act as the timestamp authority and certify the time at which the document is signed. This may be done by signing a value obtained by concatenating a timestamp with the hash of the document. Now let us consider an example that summarizes the certificate revocation problem from the perspective of signature verification. Now consider the horizontal line which represents the timeline. So there are four times that is being specified. The first time indicates when the certificate valid start date was. That was 1st January 2010. The second time represents signer's key was compromised. So the signer's key was compromised on 1st of April 2010. Third date represents the certificate revocation information received. So the certificate was revoked on 10th of April 2010. The last date indicates certificate expiry date. So the actual expiry date of the certificate was 31st December 2010. With respect to this, we'll consider four cases. First case, at time T1, the signature generation happens. At time T3, signature verification happens. So at time T1, signature generation, and at time 3, signature verification. Now the question is, does verifier accept the signature? So in this case, I can say yes, it accepts the signature. The reason is that the signature was generated at the valid period before the signer's key was compromised. So on verification, what happens? The certificate is not yet revoked, so the system will accept the signature on verification. But should the verifier accept the signature? Yes, he should accept the signature because the signature was generated at the valid period. Now we'll consider the second case. The signature generation time is T1 and the signature verification time is T4. The question is, does the system will accept the signature? Now in this case, the system won't accept the signature. The reason is, even though the signature is generated at the valid period, it is already revoked when the verification happens. So the system won't be accepting the signature. But should verifier accept the signature? Yes, the verifier can actually accept the signature. The reason is that the signature was generated at the valid period. Now consider the third case where the signature is generated at time T2 and it is verified at time T3. So in this case, Will the verifier accept the signature? Yes, he will accept the signature. But should the verifier accept the signature? No. What is the reason? Since the signature was generated at time T2, after the signer's key is compromised, there is a chance that the signature might have been generated by either by the legitimate user or by the attacker. In this case, the system shouldn't actually accept the signature, but it will, since the certificate is not revoked yet. Coming to the fourth case, the signature is generated at time T2 and it is being verified at time T4. In this case, should the system accept the signature? No, it won't. Should the verifier accept the signature? No. The reason is that when the system verifies the signature, already the certificate is revoked. So in this case, the system won't be accepting the signature. Now if we consider all the four cases, the third case is most dangerous. That is, the signature was generated at time T2 and it was verified before. It was verified before the revocation of the certificate happens, and in this case the system will accept the signature, which is the most dangerous situation. In this case, we can go for the solution 3, which is already explained. The last concept is identity based encryption, in short IBE. It is one of the alternative to digital certificate to generate public key of an user. This scheme was originally derived from Shamir's paper, wherein a person's public key could be computed as a function of that person's unique credential, such as his email address. Thus, anyone can compute anyone's public key only knowing their email address. Next, we will go through the schema in detail. IBE assumes the use of trusted third party called the private key generator. In short, it is called as PKG. Next, we'll see how the IBE schema works. Now, the public key generator, initially it will be having its private key and the associated public key. Now, the public key of the private key generator is known to every user in the network. Now, to obtain the private key, A informs the private key generator that she wishes to receive a private key corresponding to her email ID. On receiving the email ID, the public key generator makes sure that the credentials does indeed belong to A itself. The PKG also makes sure that the ID, that is the email ID, is universally unique. That is, no other individual has the same email ID. If so, PKG will generate a private key for A, which is a function of her ID and the private key of public key generator. The public key generator then securely transmits the private key to A. Now, with the knowledge of public key generator's public key and A's unique ID, that is email ID, anyone can compute A's public key. The advantage of identity-based encryption over digital certificate is that there is no need to securely transfer the public key of a user to other. He can generate on his own. So we are done with the first chapter of Module 3. Thank you for watching this video.